Hi folks, Will from MinIO here, and in this video we're going to be talking about erasure coding, which is one of the more impressive features of the MinIO storage platform. Let's go ahead and dive right in. So what we're going to be covering here is we're going to talk about what erasure coding actually is, what it does for us, and then we're going to be talking about erasure sets and also erasure parity. So what is erasure coding? This is the big question on everybody's mind. And what erasure coding is data redundancy and availability. It makes sure that MinIO can automatically reconstruct objects on the fly. There's a couple of reasons why we might want to do this. We're going to start with the first one, and that is, what happens if you lose a drive or multiple drives or even a node out of your cluster? Well, MinIO erasure coding is designed to allow you to reconstruct lost data. This gives us object level healing. It's got significantly less overhead than doing something with RAID or via replication because it's all built into the system. The way it works is each new object is split into a number of data and parity blocks. We'll talk more about that in a minute. And then these are written to an erasure set. So what's an erasure set? That's the next thing we're going to talk about. In order to get an erasure set, you have to have a minimum of one server and four drives. That is the minimum size of your cluster in order to have any kind of erasure coding in your system. So what is an erasure set? It's a group of drives onto which MinIO is going to write your erasure coded object, all your data and your parity blocks. So MinIO is going to distribute those data and parity blocks across your entire erasure set. Each drive in your erasure set is guaranteed to not have more than one of those blocks, either one of the data blocks or a parity block, and there will be no overlap. This ensures that if I lose one drive from the set, no matter what, I can still reconstruct that object. And the number of drives I can lose is really equal to the parity level that I set. We'll come back for more of that in just a second. Your erasure set size is based on the total number of nodes and drives in your server pool. So the maximum size of an erasure set is going to be 16. That is hard-coded into MinIO. You can't have an erasure set larger than 16. Your server pool is always going to be divided up into an even number of erasure sets. So that's an erasure set. It's a group of drives that holds all of your data and your parity blocks, so that not all of your data is on any single drive. So part of your erasure set is this erasure set stripe size. The stripe size is the sum of the data and parity blocks. So if I have 8 data blocks and 2 parity blocks, my stripe size is 10. It is possible to get a stripe size of 10. The maximum stripe size is always going to be equal to the erasure set size. And in fact, that's what your system is going to default to. You actually have to change the stripe size on your own when you set up your erasure coding. Stripe sizes less than the maximum have to evenly divide into the maximum. So a couple of examples. If I have an erasure set size of 16, I can have stripe sizes of 16, which would be your default, or I can go with 8 or 4, or 2. All of those are perfectly valid. If I have an erasure set of 15, because you can have erasure sets of 15, you can actually have an erasure set anything down to 4. But if I have an erasure set of 15, then my stripe sizes have to be 15, 5, or 3, because those are the ones that divide evenly into that maximum. Okay. So one of the things you're going to take away from this, obviously, I hope, is that you do not want to have a prime number of drives in your cluster, because you're going to end up with an erasure set that cannot be subdivided by stripe. We'll talk a little bit more about why you want to use a smaller stripe size than your erasure set size in just a little bit. When we're talking about parity, we were talking about our erasure code algorithms. That is how we are going to be able to reconstruct lost data. And not all erasure coding algorithms are created equally. A maximum distance separable code like Reed-Solomon gives you the greatest storage efficiency. You're going to sacrifice some other things. In some cases, you may be sacrificing a little bit of speed, but you are going to get the greatest storage efficiency when you are using Reed-Solomon. And this is why MinIO uses Reed-Solomon to take an object and split it into data and parity blocks based on the erasure set size, also possibly the erasure set stripe size, and the parity level that you set. Now, other error correction systems like turbo codes or low density parity check, they may be faster, particularly when you're working with background noise for repair rather than burst error correction. And in many cases, these are going to be used in data transmission rather than data storage, just because of the way that they function. Now, lots of different reasons why you might want to have a different one, but for MinIO, we use Reed Solomon. It's the best for our application's needs, which is storage of data and loss of blocks. Okay. So how do we perform this? Well, we set up something called our erasure code parity level. MinIO uses this ECN, that's erasure code colon N. That N is the parity number. So it's the number of parity blocks in your deployment. So if I have an erasure set stripe size of 16 and a parity of 4, I'm going to have 12 data blocks. So any object that comes in will be divided into 12 data blocks of reasonably even size. And then there will be 4 more blocks of that same size, right? So let's say I upload a 12 megabyte object. I'm going to have 12 1 megabyte data blocks, and then I'm going to add 4 more 1 megabyte parity blocks. There's a lot of math that's going on behind the scenes here. A lot of matrix analysis, matrix algebra that's going on behind the scenes here, but that's how this is going to work. So this means that I can reconstruct that object, that 12 megabyte object, from any 12 of those blocks, data or parity. So if I lose 4 of my drives in my erasure set, I can still read those objects. That's not bad. That's actually really good. So that erasure set stripe size dictates the maximum possible parity in your deployment. One is the minimum, of course. You have to have at least one parity block, otherwise there's no erasure coding going on. The maximum is going to be the stripe size divided by 2, and that rounds down. Okay, so if I have an erasure set that has 15 drives in it, for whatever reason, I have to have 7 as my maximum parity, even though 7.5 is technically 15 divided by 2. So the maximum is going to be 8, and the reason why the maximum is 8 is because our maximum erasure set, and therefore our maximum erasure set stripe size, is 16. So 8's the biggest that I can get. Okay, that is what we like to call maximum parity. At maximum parity, MinIO can tolerate the loss of half the drives in the erasure set and still perform read operations. That said, at maximum parity, in order to do write operations, I still need one additional drive. So if I have an erasure set of 16, erasure set stripe size of 16, with a parity of 8, that means I'm going to have 8 data blocks for every object and 8 parity blocks. I have to have 9 drives to write a new object so that I can write all of my data and at least one parity block. Now, is this recommended? No, you really want to repair your drives before you actually start writing more stuff. But in this maximum parity case, you have to have that additional drive there in order to be able to write at all. If I lose 8 drives, I can still read, I just can't write anymore. Okay? And this is only for the maximum parity cases. All the other cases can still read and write with an equal loss of drives. So if I have a set of 16 and a parity of 4, if I lose 4 drives, I can still write because I still have 12 drives left. So MinIO is going to default to 4 parity blocks if possible per object. That is a nice default for a set size of 16. This provides a really good balance between data loss tolerance, that is how many drives I can lose, and data storage efficiency. Now remember, if I'm doing full parity, I am going to have an equal number of parity blocks as I do data blocks, which means every object I upload is essentially twice the size. That's how we get that full parity. Now, if I don't want to do that, if I want to have a little better storage efficiency, I want to save some of that, I can do 4. And with 4, I'm actually at 75% storage efficiency because 12, 4, that's another quarter that I'm adding on every single time. Okay. There is a MinIO erasure code calculator. I'm going to show this to you here in just a second. And you can use this when you are planning and designing your MinIO deployment to explore all the different effects of erasure code settings on your intended topology. So let me go ahead and jump over. Let's show you that MinIO product erasure code calculator. So here is our erasure code calculator. As you can see, it allows us to do all kinds of different calculations. Here I've got one rack, I've got 8 servers in that rack. Each server has 16 drives. It handily means that I have a maximum stripe size of 16. That's my erasure set size is going to be 16. I can also do this as an 8 or a 4 or a 2. If I do this as 8, it impacts the maximum parity I can do. Obviously, my maximum parity on 8 is going to be 4 because that's half. Notice when I do a erasure code stripe size of 8 and my maximum parity is 4, I am at full parity, which means I can lose half of my drives, 4 out of 8 drives. Okay, 64 drives total across my entire setup. I can lose half of my servers even and still maintain the ability to read objects out of my cluster. Now, notice that my raw capacity is basically 1 petabyte because I've got 8 terabytes per drive. So I've got 1 petabyte, but unfortunately my usable capacity is only half of that because half of my drive space is going to parity blocks. Now, if I wanted to reduce this, maybe I take it down to 2. So now I'm at 75%, and this is where we try to get to. Our default is 4. When we go to 16, we default to 4. That's the same 75% efficiency that we like to have. Again, I can lose 4 out of 16 drives. 32 drives in my cluster total can be lost. And I can lose 2 of my 8 servers in this case. But let's say we wanted to set up a smaller cluster. Maybe we only want 4 servers and we only have 8 drives per server. Now you may think to yourself, well, wait a minute, if 8 drives per server is the maximum I can have, isn't my stripe size gonna have to be 8? Well, no. Even with 4 servers with 8 drives per, I can have 2 erasure sets of 16. So I can still do this 16 stripe size, but I can only lose one of my servers. What MinIO is going to do is it's going to distribute those data and parity blocks in such a manner that I can still lose an entire server, all 8 of its drives going down, and I can still get all of my data back out if I need to. So that is part of how our calculation is going to work. This is how the server is going to work in the back end. It gives you the command line you need to start this up. And we'll talk a little bit more about the command line in just a little bit. But this gives us our nodes, it gives us our drives, and it shows us how much usable capacity we have left based on our drive capacity. So this is a very powerful tool. Definitely take a look at this when you're starting to plan your deployment cluster for production. And as a side note, you may want to reach out to us. You notice the little Ask an Expert down there at the bottom. You may want to reach out to us because MinIO does offer architectural reviews to help you make the right choices with the size of your cluster, your erasure code stripe size, and all that other fun stuff. Okay, let's get back to the slides. So here is some example outcomes of some parity settings. I'm not talking about how much drive space is on each drive. This is literally just about your parity settings. I'm working with a total of 16 drives, so I'm showing you how many data blocks you're going to get. Obviously, the number of parity blocks you're going to get is there in the parity column. But the nice thing about this is that it gives you some idea of the scale of your storage efficiency and still be able to read. Now, lower parity means you get better storage efficiency, but lower drive loss tolerance because the parity is going to be the number of drives that can be lost from the set. Okay, so with 16 drives, we like to default to 4. That gives us 12 data blocks, 4 parity blocks. We can lose 4 drives and we're still maintaining 75% of our storage for new data rather than parity blocks. So just something to keep in mind that you'll get the same output if you run all these numbers through our calculator online as well. So some things to think about. If I have a single server with 4 drives, again, this is the minimum. I have a maximum stripe size of 4. Obviously, I can't have a stripe size larger than the number of drives I have. This means that I can have a parity of 2 or 1. I would go with 1, right? A parity of 2 means I'm using half of my data for parity blocks, and if I only have 4 drives, that's not a lot. A poorly designed cluster, if I had 3 servers with 17 drives each, this is why you don't want to do this. I can still do erasure coding, but the only available stripe size for this is going to be 3. I'm going to have a lot of them, but it's only going to be 3. And then our only parity available is 1 because I can't do anything other than 1 when I have 3 for my erasure set stripe size. Okay, so just something to keep in mind. So if I'm designing my cluster, a cluster with 4 servers and 8 drives per server can still support that erasure set size of 16, as I showed you on our calculator. A stripe size of 8 or 4 might be more practical, however. This is going to impact your available parity settings, but why would I choose a stripe size smaller than my erasure set size? Well, when you're designing your cluster, you need to take into account your data requirements, okay? Parity dictates the number of drives which can be lost without data loss. Of course, that is important to everybody, but distributing a smaller set size across multiple servers also protects against loss. So if I have a stripe size of 8 with a parity of 2, I still get that 75%. I can still lose 2 drives out of my erasure set and still have everything be okay, but this is going to give me maybe better distribution. Maybe I can lose a server in this case as well. So a lower stripe size also, and this is important, a lower stripe size means each block will be larger, and this can have a very positive impact on throughput if your application is dealing in very small objects. If I have to take a 1 megabyte object and divide it 16 ways, then we start running into things like the drive's actual block size, and am I wasting drive space with that smaller block? So a lower stripe size could be an issue. Smaller objects will generally benefit from a lower stripe size. And this again is where I'm going to say a MinIO architectural review can help you with these critical design decisions. When you are starting up your server pool with erasure coding enabled, the MinIO server command has to specify all the hosts in the pool and all the drives for each host. So, if we are using our naming convention, we want to make sure that our DNS entries for each server should include the rack number and then the node number and then whatever fully qualified domain name we're using. And then on top of that, our drive mounts should be /mount/drive 1234567. This allows us to use this very clever single line command without having to put in a bunch of different entries. Note that if I do more than one entry, that's actually going to set up different clusters. So in order to use this as one cluster, we need to follow this naming convention. But this allows us to say MinIO server, HTTPS, rack 1, 2, node 1 through 4, example.net, and then we're using drives 1 through 8 on each of those nodes in each of the racks. So this is going to give us a nice little erasure set size of 16. We have a total of 64 drives here that we're working with. BitRot protection is the last thing I want to talk about. One of the cool things that we've talked about so far is being able to lose a drive and still recover. But BitRot recovery is something else that is given to us with our Reed-Solomon algorithms, okay? BitRot is when you have silent data corruption. You don't know what happened. It could be a current spike that flipped a magnetic bit on your drive. You may have a problem with your flash memory. There may be an issue with a driver that causes a bad write or a bad read. You can even have a random cosmic ray come in and flip a bit on your drive. You don't know what's even happening. MinIO implements a highway hash to capture and heal corrupted objects on the fly. Now, what's going to happen is when you write that object, we're going to calculate the hash and make it part of the metadata. And every time I do a read, I'm going to check that hash. Highway hash is very, very quick, so it's very easy for me to do that hash very quickly. It's very easy for me to check that hash on every single read. What happens if it comes back and it says the hash doesn't match? Well, then I know I have data corruption. So what do? Then I rebuild the object using my Reed-Solomon parity blocks. Okay, so this is one more tool that we can get out of using our Reed-Solomon. And the fact that we have our write once, read many allows us to do this very quickly. So with highway hash, we can detect silent data corruption. We can detect that bit rot and fix it before it ever sees your application. That's everything I have for you on erasure coding. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you'd like to reach out with us, you can chat with us on slack.min.io. You can use any of the methods you see here on the screen, or you can just give us a reply here on the video. Thanks, and we'll see you for the next one.